Rooms Ministries presents The Testimony of Jesus.
My name is Lazarus. Feels good to be alive. When I in chains of death was bound, this man named Jesus.
1 Peter 2:24. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might die to sin and live unto righteousness. For by his stripes you were healed.
Living testimony of his death-defying touch. My name is Lazarus.
Join us as we witness this same Jesus as he transforms and restores lives today. Experience real passion for Jesus Christ.
Welcome to Healing Rooms Ministries, where the testimony of Jesus is a spirit of prophecy. I'm Cal Pierce, Director of Healing Rooms Ministry, and your host today. And I have with me as my co-host, my wife, Michelle, who is co-director of Healing Rooms Ministries. Yep. So it's good to have her here today. And today we have a guest with us, and his name is Todd Callahan. And Todd has just a powerful testimony. Yeah. Actually, Todd, your testimony is probably one of the first testimonies that we encountered in the Healing Rooms, or at least close to that. God had touched you at our first spiritual hunger conference. And yes. You know, here we are down the road, almost 7 years, about to have our number eight, I believe it is. Mm-hmm. And so we had our first spiritual hunger conference. It was like 2 or 3 months after we opened the Healing Rooms. We opened July 22nd, and I believe that was in September.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So when I think back about that, it's hard for me to imagine how we even did that. You know, how did those conferences are so much work.
Yes.
And because now we have like 3,000 people coming, and this was at the Davenport Hotel.
Yes.
And
Before it was even open.
Yeah, before it was even opened, and remodeled as it is today. But we had it in the lobby, and I remember that, having the stage on one end, the fountain in the middle, and the fireplace at the other end. So we had the water and the fire. We had all these prophetic symbols going on there, and we had Bill Johnson and Randy Clark as our guest speakers. And of course, this year, Bill and Randy are coming back again, you know, 7 years later.
That's right.
And so tell us about what you were battling when you came, because it was not just physical, but you had some, you know, you weren't sure about this whole thing.
Tell us
a little bit.
We'd been battling our story actually started with our daughter's birth. She was born before the Spiritual Hunger Conference 7 years ago. She was born in 90, and at 3 months old, started to grow tumors on her back, little bumps. And they thought they were benign. They said, don't worry about it. But as a parent, you know, as your little baby has these bumps on their back. So we went from doctor to doctor. When she was 4, we had them taken out. They said, pray they don't come back. And they came back the next year. And this time the Lord led us to another doctor who said, even though these things aren't cancer, there's this tissue, tumors. Uh-huh. We got to find out why. Yeah. And he sent tissue samples to Utah. And the report came back, it's probably a long shot, and they almost didn't even consider it. But if it's what we think it might be, you have to check the parents, because it's a very serious disease that causes colon cancer. So at 35 years old, an accountant, doing great, wonderful, I went into a doctor's office and went through a procedure, and they found not only did she have the disease, I had the disease and had full-blown colon cancer. Wow. And that started our journey. And I went through surgeries, 3 surgeries later, and about a year and a half later they went in and they found a tumor that was under the heart. They'd taken out the colon and all the cancer, they thought, but there was a tumor right under the heart. And this was visually sighted by the surgeon. And he sewed me back up and went out into the room and told Anna Marie, just go home and get everything in order. This tumor is growing and it'll take him out. Just go get your affairs in order. We can't treat it without treating him. The tumor was in to the mesenteric artery, which is right where the heart is. And the kind of tumor it is, it just grows in with fingers, and he was crying as much as my wife, and, wow. and just a very sad day.
So if this hadn't happened to your daughter, you wouldn't know that.
No, I would have just gone home.
Wow.
But God, yes. God was in every step of the way.
Yes.
And he let us find it in our daughter so that they would look to me
yes.
and begin the healing process and start by saving my life. But then a year and a half into this, I was... the large colon was gone. I was in intense pain after the surgery. I had a tumor that was declared terminal and sent home to die.
Right.
And had been in the church and was a believer and had lots of prayer. And a couple that we knew from church came and said, "We're taking some training for these rooms that are going to open up where they pray for the sick."
And
they said, "We would like your family." We got child care. They got some friends that would watch the kids. They paid for a hotel room, and they, I think, told your team that I was going to come, and they said, "It's three or 4 days, just come, and let's see what God wants to do."
Oh. Yeah, because you were in a world of hurt when you
yes,
came.
I yes, mean, you pain had to, and very weak, and yeah, in and out of
that.
A wheelchair,
yeah.
and just hurting. And,
yeah.
And in fact, getting ready for the conference, just out of desperation, my wife said, "Lord, please just touch him, just heal him, and heal him fast." just come, Lord. And we went into the conference, and it was in the Davenport, which was beautiful, even though it wasn't the remodeled like it is today. But it was just a wonderful setting. I just came in, and I didn't know Bill Johnson or Randy Clark or anything about healing or what God wanted to do in the in lives like that. I was just a hurting person.
You just came without any foundation for healing, or you're just desperate.
Just desperate, yes. Yeah. And our friends, Al and Gloria, had invited us, so we trusted them, and it felt like a safe place to come and get prayer.
Yeah.
And so Bill Johnson started it was the morning session, and there was, the evenings are usually more people, and the morning was pretty light, so Bill said, "Let's just pray for everybody. So everybody here, let's just all line up and we'll just pray for everyone," because it was a small group of people, and he felt like he could do that.
Yeah.
So I came down and stood, for prayer, and Bill was coming by, and it wasn't even a prayer for healing. It was more kind of a just bless you, feel you, touch you, bless you. And he was just kind of going down the line, letting everyone have a blessing from the Lord. And I'd seen the Holy Spirit move and had never experienced that, but I knew that this was a safe place. No one knew me except Al and Gloria, and there was a big guy behind me, so and nobody would know me. So I said, "Lord, I'm just desperate for you." So I could have stayed standing, I was strong enough to stand, but.
Yeah.
I felt something, and just almost out of a hunger or desperation, I said, "Lord, I'm just going to lay down." And I leaned back, and the gentleman just set me down on the ground. And then Bill went right on and prayed for others. And I just laid on the ground, and I remember not feeling anything, anything that you're supposed to feel, but just saying, "Lord, I'm tired, and I can't, you got to show up."
Yeah.
And I had done this when I would go into surgeries, and I was laying on the gurney. When I would pray to God, sometimes I would raise my hands. So I would be on the gurney and raise my hands to the Lord before I went in for the surgeries. And laying on the carpet there at the Davenport, I just raised my hands to the Lord, and I said, "God, you've got to show up. I need you. I can't do this without you." And it was like... at that moment, I felt warmth and then electricity, and I started to shake or quake, and just a powerful, tangible presence of God.
Yes.
And people came by and prayed for me, and I just, the next thing I know, they said, "It's time for lunch. You've been here for about 2 hours." And they stood me up, and I just had the heart of God, and actually... chased down a wheelchair to pray for the person in the wheelchair.
And
when I went to the doctor the next time for the CAT scan to look for the tumor, the gentleman that creates the reports, he wouldn't say it had disappeared, but he said that where the tumor was, there's a shadow of the tumor.
A shadow.
So I've lived in the shadow.
Yeah.
Since.
Yeah.
In his shadow.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, that's awesome.
So that began the healing process, and obviously that I'm not terminal.
No.
I'm
yeah.
still here.
Yeah.
7 years
yeah.
later, and it just began the process, and then I would come to the rooms, and I remember you. Then I started to learn and become knowledge and gain knowledge about how healing comes, and it can be dramatic like that to take the tumor out. And then you taught me, you know, it's a process. So continue to receive prayer, to continue to walk it out. And
yes.
sometimes it's a process. And over the 7 years, I've become stronger, and it's been a process of healing. So I've had both. I had the miracle. At the beginning, and then it's been a process of walking it out too.
Wow.
And receiving prayer and coming to the rooms and
and
seeing it manifest like that.
You know, the Bible says that the presence of the Lord comes to heal.
Yes.
You know, and you felt that presence.
Yes.
And so when you're laying on the floor, just the presence of God came. Now, did the 2 hours just
minutes.
It was,
yes.
Yeah, you were just caught up in that presence, and
in
time
his presence, yes.
just disappears.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
as you know, because the Spirit of God just kind of does a surgery.
That's just what I was thinking. He does the surgery, yes.
You know? Yes. And that's what it felt like. And the team told me later that people prayed for me, and so for those 2 hours while I was in his presence, the team members would come by and pray, and so they were doing what they were supposed to, and God did what He did. So,
yeah,
that's so cool.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
That is so cool.
Yes.
You know, and now you and your wife have come to go through the training, become part of the Healing Rooms team.
Yes.
So you've been on the team for how long?
Well, officially, just a few months. I mean, immediately afterwards, I was ready to sign up.
Yeah.
So God said, no, go to the rooms and get the healing and walk that out. And we kept, probably every couple months, I would say, Lord, is it time to go in and pray? Because I just have a heart for the sick to see them healed, to receive what I received. I want to see others receive so much.
Yes.
And so this January, the Lord said, go in, it's time. So we took the training and went in, and that's been just such a blessing.
Now you've never been on the team?
Not officially. No,
I
probably thought
you
because I was around.
Because
somewhere.
You were around.
Yes,
you kept coming in for prayer.
Yes, came in for prayer, and anytime you had training or teaching.
Yeah, I remember you at the training.
Yes.
You and your wife.
Yes, always there. But to actually get in the rooms and to pray for the sick, God said, "I'll tell you when," and it was now.
So, how exciting!
Yes. Yes.
See, so it's okay to wait on God, because
yes.
He really knows the right time when He's going to fulfill your destiny.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, you know, because we all have a destiny.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Every person.
Yeah, and this is just a perfect example of you know, I think part of why healing is a process, because, I mean, if in that encounter, you know, just everything was done and you were finished, you know, you may not have pursued God like you did in the process. So so the Spirit of God wants to come lead us into truth. And of course, in that encounter with the Holy Spirit, that healing process started. And then God began to teach you about His Word and then started releasing destiny when you came into the healing rooms.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
So that's a process that God wants to put us into, because He's not just interested in healing your body.
That's right.
He's interested in the destiny that you and your wife have, and he wants to release that destiny for a whole family.
That's right.
Yes, yes. And that's our prayer now. Is I've seen the healing manifest in my body, and of course it's the doctors are still. They know the facts that the disease that caused all this trouble is still there, and so I have to go through monitoring and go in there and I'm still working through that transition. But our daughter, who we discovered the disease through, she's 15 now, and we're praying for miracles as she starts to grow, that the disease will will be stopped. Now that'll be a miracle because the doctors have never seen the disease not manifest itself with the tumors and the cancer. And but we're believing for miracles. And
has she been well, or has she had to go and have operations?
She's had operations. It's been as aggressive in her as it was in me. But God's met us at every step.
And
she hasn't had to have major surgeries, but she's had tumors removed and the scoping process. But we just, you know, we're standing that it's going to be a family miracle.
Amen.
That's right.
Contending for that complete manifestation.
Yes, if it was impossible for me to be healed, then it's no more hard for God to heal our daughter, our son.
Yeah, he's no respecter of persons.
No, no.
How old is your son now?
He's 11.
Okay.
So we have a 15-year-old girl, and she's fighting the disease, and a 14-year-old boy who doesn't have the disease, an 11-year-old boy that does, and then a 4-year-old who we won't test until he's about 8 years old.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we appreciate prayer for the
miracle
of the family.
Yes, you know, in Galatians 3:13 tells us that we've been redeemed from the curse. And, and that it's that redemption, that redemptive value that that we need to call forth in cases like this that breaks that generational curse. You know, it's interesting that that this year, as we're doing this taping, that here again, Randy.
Yes.
Clark.
Randy
Clark
and Bill,
and
are,
Bill
coming
are coming back again. Yes. You know, so when you were talking about your children, you know, that might be a good place to bring them.
Yes,
you know,
they'll be on the front
maybe something.
Yeah,
they'll be on the front row.
Right,
that they will. Oh. Yeah, amen. And well, we're going to just contend for that complete healing in your family. So so now, how has this affected like how your family functions, your lifestyle, and so on? Has it been?
Well, I was on, and still am on disability, and am improving consistently. But a few years ago at our church, our pastor, who had come in and was a new pastor and was the temporary pastor, said, you know, I don't have any position or title or money or anything, but I need help ministering and pastoring this flock. Would you just come on board and help? And so I did hospital visits and small groups and just wherever there was a hole, just filled in and continued to do that, and just was a perfect opportunity because they didn't have to have a full-time person, which I couldn't be, but I can sure minister and love people and pray for people and be there. So for the past 3 years, I've been helping with the church there, and I'm taking the training and to be a licensed minister.
Minister, oh,
so, see, oh, that's awesome.
God will bring you even further in. You know, He won't allow the enemy to get one inch of victory in your life.
Yes.
No, He's the victory in your life.
Yes.
I find it interesting that you said, you know, that when you first found out that you had it and all, you didn't really know about healing.
No, just not like, I'd been in the church and knew about Jesus and salvation and those things, but hadn't, I guess, because, I mean, we'd gotten a lot of prayer for Sarah, but I hadn't heard teaching like the teaching that you hear from the rooms now and from Bill Johnson and Randy Clark's and the different teachers.
I know. It's interesting what God does with us to, I know in our life, because of our son, David, who is with the Lord now. He passed away in 92, but he was born with muscular dystrophy. And I can remember when we were raising him, I had all these people would come up and dream of him walking and such, but I never could catch that because I didn't have any foundation. Mine was, my foundation was, if it's His will. And so I just went on that, and I never stood on really what the Word of God said. And that's so important, you know, that we need to know what the Word says for each of us. And not just, okay, if it's your will, Lord. No, what is His will? His will is that all should be healed. He took care of it on the cross. His will is that we should all get to walk in our destiny. He doesn't want the enemy to steal any of our destiny. That's His will. I didn't know it then, and my son is now in heaven. But my son, through his walk with God, even with muscular dystrophy, changed our life. He, it really did, even though, you know, he went to be with heaven. Praise God.
And it's those prayers that of his.
It
because
is.
Back then we were, you know, in what we call a religious spirit or religious mode. We knew just enough of the word to
make us miserable.
To make us sort of miserable, so to speak.
Yes.
But the foundation is important on truth, because you know, the word tells us that God says, "My people perish for lack of knowledge." And why is that? Because that foundation of truth that you were lacking as that truth came in.
Yes.
That's the word of God is the truth, and it produces faith.
That's right.
And faith is the substance of what you hope for, the evidence, the reality of what you don't yet have, and it brings it into being.
Yes.
As God began to work in you, and I remember, Todd, when you, as you were being healed from that time, you began to testify to the healing power of God.
Yes.
And that testimony is an expression of creative faith. Mm. It's an expression of that will of God coming right out of your mouth, prophesying.
Yes.
That that our God is Jehovah Rapha. He's the God of healing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And he's a God who has who treats one just like he does another, and that's what I love about those testimonies.
Yes.
And
because
you've been a living testimony.
Praise God.
Yeah. It's still a testimony for the future, you know. But it's important what we speak, you know, the faith that we have. And I know we've heard testimonies of people who have been prayed for, and they start. You know, they just immediately start saying, yes, I'm healed. Lord, I am healed.
Yes.
You know, and yet the manifestation hasn't taken place yet.
Right.
But out of their mouth, they speak what the Word of God says.
Mm-hmm.
And they believe it, and then it takes place. They don't doubt it. And that's where we have to come to. We have to come to a place where we don't go by what we see, like you preach, honey. We don't go by what we see, but what the Word of God says.
Yes.
And that's what you're showing. You're going by what the Word says.
Yes.
You're healed. You don't care about that shadow.
Yes.
You're healed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And without that foundation, of course, in a case like where Todd was, without that living Word to be activated in him, then his confession has to line up with the will of the enemy in a way, because your testimony is, I'm sick. Your testimony isn't what the Word says, it's what the enemy has done to make you sick. And then that perpetuates the work of the enemy, because if faith is the substance of things hoped for, fear is the substance of things not desired.
That's right.
You know, and the confession of fear is, well, I have terminal cancer, you know, and that's what you were told. You were told you're terminal, but then all of a sudden you began to realize, hey, I don't serve a terminal God.
That's right.
I serve a God who brings life.
Yes.
And,
yes.
And he came and got a hold of you at that conference, and he brought life.
Yes.
That's right.
Because you had an encounter.
Yes.
You know, if the Word of God doesn't take us to an encounter with God, it'll just make us more religious.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, and what we don't need is just more religion. We need truth.
Yes.
We need a truth that'll set us free.
Yes.
Not a fear or a lack of truth that will bind us up.
Yes.
No, that's right.
Yes.
You know?
And it was at that point of desperation that God met me. I don't care what it looks like, or, you know, I think about it. I just need you.
Yeah.
That's
need
right.
you to show up. And he showed up strong.
Well, and a lot of people get the idea that that God brings sickness to make us desperate. You know, the enemy brings sickness, but it's in the midst of that trial that God shows up, because we, you know, sometimes we don't get desperate until we get into a place of desperation, you know, and that's just the way we are, because we have a tendency to get too comfortable in the way we are. And when affliction comes, it comes against the Word, you know, to take us out. But you know, I like that. You know, you're desperate enough to pursue God, to pursue truth, and that truth sets you free. You know, and it's still working.
It's still working, right? And I just wanted to say, you know, to the people that are watching us, the importance of knowing what the Word of God says on the promises that He has. And you don't have to, you just go for the promises on healing and look it up, mm-hmm. the word healing, and go for the promises to get those promises into your spirit.
Yes.
And that, I mean, if you'll just do that mm-hmm. and start speaking the truth of the Word.
Yes.
And we also have, I'd like to mention too, that we have healing rooms all over the world, all over the nation here. And if you just go to healingrooms.com mm-hmm. and go to your state or the country, if you know somebody that's very sick or you yourself need healing, find a healing room in that area and go to it for personal prayer. It's a safe place. The one thing we can say about healing rooms, it's a safe place where you will be treated with love and the Spirit of God will come in and take care of things. And you can also just email us and ask for a prayer cloth or ask for prayer, and we put it up. We just gave a testimony before about someone who just called in with a prayer request, and the Lord healed that person without them ever having hands laid on. So I just, you know, I wanted to bring that to the attention of our viewers that we're there for.
And we also need to encourage our viewers that God is concerned with what we're concerned with. You know, that it doesn't matter how small of a battle you're fighting or how large, you know, whether the doctors have said you have terminal cancer or whether you just have a sore on your finger, you know. You know, God is big enough for both, you know, and we get this idea that, well, I just have to worry about the big things. I just have to put up with this little pain. You know, you really don't. He's a God of love, and the healing is an expression of His love for His children, because Jesus bore our sickness. He didn't go to the cross to bear some of it. He didn't go to the cross to bear the hard stuff. He went to the cross to bear it all, whether it's not so hard or whether it is. And and it's not hard for God.
Actually, if you
that's our, that
if
needs
you
to be
go
our
to
understanding.
Him, if you go to Him on the little things and you see how God can work, you know, it gives you more faith when the big things come. Because you're seeing, well, He'll even heal you the little things.
Amen. Well, we just want to pray for the viewer. You know, if you're watching this program, Jesus is your healer. Mm-hmm. You can lay hands on yourself. He can do right there what He does here or what He does in a conference or at the healing room. He can touch you right where you're at. So just lay hands on yourself and say, Jesus, heal my body today in Jesus' name. I receive it by faith, and I give you the glory for the healing in Jesus' name. So we want to thank you for showing up, for watching the program today in Jesus' name. God bless you. See you next time.
A living testimony of His death-defying time.